Hello people, in this video let us understand this topic, claw hand. So you can see the hand here. This is the right hand, right? Just make your two fingers, the little finger and the next one, the ring finger, right? Just bend them, okay, like this. And let me tell you, wait. You have to extend this part. This part is extended and this part is flexed. Okay, so first what you do, you extend this joint, the metacarpal joint, metacarpal phalanx joint that you extend for these two fingers, but this joint you flex. Okay, so that is claw hand. See, basically this is the, because of ulnar nerve deformity, ulnar nerve injury. Okay, so here you can see now open your right hand, okay, and look at this, your right hand, like this right hand you look at. See, the ulnar nerve is supplying sensory innervation for these two fingers. Okay, the sensory innervation for these two fingers. Right? The little and the half of this index finger looks like. Ring finger. Yeah, half of this ring finger. Okay. That's the sensory innervation. So, we are concerned only with ulnar nerve, isn't it? And even dorsally, it seems to be giving for these three fingers. This ulnar nerve is also called as musician's nerve. So let us just look at how it goes. So it's coming here from your brachial plexus. So it is on the medial side to your humerus. Right? It's on the medial side again. So please keep your right hand outstretched and just trace it. Ulnar nerve is on the medial of your humerus. Then it is going behind your medial epicondyle of the humerus. And then it is coming by the side of your ulna, that is the ulna bone, right, by the medial side, and then it is proceeding, look at this, to innervate these fingers, okay. So, if there is a fracture here at the medial epicondyle of the humerus, what will happen? There will be ulnar nerve injury. So, one of the causes of claw hand is fracture of the medial epicondyle of humerus. Okay, so this is what the topic, claw hand. The causes, one is fracture of the medial epicondyle of humerus, basically ulnar nerve injury. This is what you have to understand, main thing. This is the cause, ulnar nerve injury. The causes, fracture of medial epicondyle of humerus, that is because of trauma. Leprosy can damage the nerve. We know this, leprosy. The Mycobacterium leprae, the bacteria. Compressive neuropathy, so any compression at this point, then it could be much higher up, okay, where it is affected, like, let's see, the brachial plexus itself are affected, or there is a T1 root compression, polio, syringomyelia, motor neuron disease, Charcot-Marie-Tooth disease, etc. So let's understand this one. Where is this T1 root compression? What are they saying? See, these are your brachial plexus and that one is T1. So if there is a T1 compression, so the medial cord, ulnar nerve is coming here. So this can get affected. So you've understood this virus, polio virus, etc. can go and sit there and cause this problem. What is this terminology, syringomyelia? Myelia, myelin, something to do with spinal cord. Okay, they are saying that there is a fluid filled cyst, syrinx, within the spinal cord. We should make notes, right? Syringomyelia is fluid filled cyst within spinal cord. Okay, then what about this? Charcot-Marie-Tooth disease, hereditary motor and sensory neuropathy. Some neuropathy, basically some nerve is affected. Okay. So virus can cause compression, bacteria like leprosy, bacteria can cause compressive neuropathy. Then at a higher level itself, it could have been affected, like the T1 root compression, brachial plexus of medial cord of brachial plexus being affected, etc. Or trauma, fracture, okay, of the medial epicondyle of the humerus. So what and all have you seen so far? Look at this. Let's take a recap of what we have seen. Claw hand is a deformity, okay, what is there? Hyperextension at the metacarpophalangeal joint. So, we already told you, hyperextend the metacarpophalangeal joint and then flex the interphalangeal joint. You have to flex, okay? For which finger? Those two fingers. The little finger and the ring finger, okay? Now, if only ulnar nerve is involved, you will see this ulnar claw hand or partial claw hand. This is ulnar claw hand or partial claw hand, okay? But if median nerve is also involved, then all four fingers get involved, okay? That time it is called as complete claw hand. This is a total complete or a combined claw hand, and this is also called as ape hand or simian hand, okay? So this is something very, very important. Under claw hand, we have two types of claw hand now. Ulnar claw hand, where only two fingers are affected. Combined or total claw hand, or ape hand or simian hand, where all the four fingers are involved, okay? So, some concept we have understood about claw hand. Now, let us develop it further. They will ask you, what are the muscles involved? Just say, right, lumbricals are paralyzed and you will get marks. What's the job of lumbricals, guys? It will flex the metacarpophalangeal joint. So, you can see here, the metacarpophalangeal joint is flexed, right? And there is extension, there should be extension. So, you bend your little finger like this. So, this is the job of the, the lumbricals. So, if your little finger is like this, metacarpoflexed, extended interphalangeal joint. Okay? So, that is your job of your lumbricals. But that gets paralyzed now. So, instead of flexion here, there's an extension here. Okay? See, instead of flexion here at the metacarpophalangeal joint, there's an extension here. And at the interphalangeal joint, there's a flexion. So, can you understand now how it is? So, this is what is the claw hand lumbricals are paralyzed, okay? See, now they are trying to explain in more great words. They're saying at any joint, there's a balance which is maintained by flexors on one side and extensors on one side. So, basically, at the metacarpophalangeal joint, the flexor, who is the flexor? It's the lumbrical. But now, this one has got paralyzed. So, metacarpophalangeal joint will go into extension. Then here, actually, they are mentioning one more muscle name, okay? The extensor digitorum is supposed to be the extensor. So, look at this. Extensor is at the bottom, right? It's the extensor. But now that the lumbrical is not working, the extensor will work and it will extend the metacarpophalangeal joint, okay? So a lot of other things they have mentioned here. We will not go into the details. What is happening at the proximal interphalangeal joint? The extensor is the extensor expansion. I think they didn't mention the lumbrical here, okay? Anyways, some other muscles. So just remember some two muscles, that much be enough for now, okay? So there is, in ulnar nerve injury, there is paralysis of all the introsci and medial two lumbricals. So you understood medial two lumbricals will get paralyzed, that we have been telling. They have also included introsci here. Let's proceed because it will not get over at all otherwise. There is not only injury to these muscles which are doing extension flexion, also because of this kind of position, etc., there can be muscle wasting, okay? Understand that there is wasting because of not proper use, right? So, the hypothenar eminence, which is this thing, okay? The hypothenar eminence, this one, see, there is wasting there, okay? There is hollowing between the metacarpals, hollowing it is. So, here there will be hollowing, okay? So, that is between your metacarpals. Guys, do you know that you learned something like, other than ulnar nerve, if median nerve is affected, then all the four fingers are affected, right? Now, look at that here, where you will get the ape hand or the complete or total claw hand. There, in addition to those two lumbricals, the other two lumbricals also, lateral two lumbricals also are involved. Okay, that much if you write, that's enough, I feel. Okay, now one more additional concept we are adding here, guys. Just one concept, that is, there is something called as high ulnar nerve and low ulnar nerve injury, okay? So, what happens in high ulnar nerve and low ulnar nerve? Obviously, you are expecting the two lumbricals to get affected, that you are sure, right? And hypothenar muscles wasting and all that also they have mentioned. But in addition to this, see, they have mentioned some flexors as FCU, FDP are affected. Can you see here? In the muscles paralyzed, if it is a little higher up, some more muscles are affected. See this? Okay, other than this hypothenar, intraossei, medial two lumbricals and adductor pollicis, they are saying some extra muscles are affected. Can you see that here, guys? This one, these two. So what happens in ulnar, high ulnar nerve palsy, because these two muscles are involved, the defect will look less severe. That is what is the ulnar paradox. Okay, that is what is ulnar paradox. Look at this. Ulnar paradox. Ulnar paradox means the high ulnar nerve injury will look less severe than the low one. Now look at this one. This is the high ulnar nerve injury. Actually, in this, you can see the bending of these two fingers is not that much, right? In this, the FDP, the flexor digitorum profundus, is also paralyzed. But in this one, where it is a low injury, that is at wrist level, there's more clawing of the fingers, okay, due to unopposed FDP. So that's what you should understand, that the high ulnar nerve injury will look less severe than a low ulnar nerve injury. Will look more severe. The clawing will be more severe of these fingers. That is the ulnar paradox, okay? And there's one more thing, guys. If there's ulnar and median nerve injury also, the clawing is not that much, okay? Now, let us go to what problems these people will have, okay? Problems of claw hand. So, what will happen if they have claw hand? They cannot grasp, okay? Grasp is severely affected. Pinch is affected to a certain extent. You can't pinch, okay? You can't grasp, you can't pinch, you can't hook. Fine. Then grasping is a big problem they are seeing. Okay, anyways, we will not look at that. Now let's go to the treatment of claw hand. How will you treat? Actually, in the table itself, treatment was written, right? Bring the table. See this. Zancoli's procedure, extensor indices, extensor digiti minimi tendon transfer. Zancoli's procedures, extensor indices, extensor digiti minimi tendon transfer. Same thing they have written for both. For both high and low ulna, they have written the same thing. Okay, what is the principle of correction? You want to prevent hyperextension at the metacarpophalangeal joint. So easily they are saying hyperextension at the metacarpophalangeal joint you want to prevent, right? So you want this extensor digitorum to act less, correct? That is the one that is extending. So you want to stop the hyperextension, right? So what you want to do? Instead of asking this extensor digitorum to extend the metacarpophalangeal joint, they are making it work on the interphalangeal joint. Wow, this is like very, very interesting, right? This, did you understand? The extensor digitorum, see this extensor digitorum, instead of what it is doing, it is extending this joint, which it should not extend. And this side, something is getting flexed, right? So what they are doing, whatever is... like this, they are extending the tendon and putting it to the interphalangeal joint. So, something like, what was like this, now will become like something which is like this will become V here and then extend here. It will become like this. So this is the fix. So you're putting the extensor digitorum, you're putting it ahead, you're pulling it and putting that extensor digitorum ahead so that whatever it was extending, now it will extend the interphalangeal joint. Okay. And it will not work on the metapharyngeal anymore. This is the tendon transfer. So extensor carpi radialis brevis longus. This is Paul Brand's procedure. Extensor indices, extensor digiti minimi, Fowler procedure, flexor digitorum superficialis of the middle or ring finger, Sterling-Bunnell procedure. These names are really difficult to remember. There are some other tendon transfers that they are talking about. Okay, Paul Brand, Fowler. Okay, we'll see all that. Rerouting the tendon. The Zancoli we saw, right? This is the name that they told. Zancoli. We'll use this name. So here they are talking about how to reroute that tendon. See if you can understand. Okay. Then, so this is what they are telling. Paul Brand. You saw this name, right? Paul Brand. And there are some splinting also they are talking about. Gutter splint, knuckle bender splint, cast. So all this also you can write. Now let's take a recap of this video. Claw hand. Basically, there are two types of claw hand. You have the ulnar claw hand, only where two fingers are affected, and the total or combined claw hand, ape hand, where you have all the four fingers involved. Okay. So if you are talking about this type of claw hand, which is the ulnar claw hand, it is because of the ulnar nerve injury. This can happen because of the ulnar nerve supplies these two fingers, right? The little and the ring finger. So basically, the ulnar nerve injury can happen because of fracture of medial epicondylar humerus, or because of leprosy, or because of some compression. Or at a higher level, there can be medial cord or brachial plexus which are affected, or a T1 root compression, polio, syringomyelia, which is nothing but fluid filled cyst within the spinal cord, motor neuron disease, right? Then, so you have the, we told you about this, all these extra things that cause the claw hand deformity, okay? So basically, claw hand, what will be there here? There will be a hyperextension at the metacarpophalangeal joint and flexion at the interphalangeal joint. Okay. So, what else? The muscles involved are basically the lumbricals are paralyzed. Okay. So what will happen if the lumbricals are paralyzed? This is what will happen. Hyperextension at the metacarpophalangeal joint and flexion at the interphalangeal joint, because the actual job was to flex the metacarpophalangeal joint and extend the interphalangeal joint. Now that this muscle is, the lumbricals is paralyzed, what will overact? The extensor digitorum will overact and it will extend, hyperextend the metacarpophalangeal joint. Okay, and there are a lot of other muscles involved too. Okay, interossei and a lot of things they are telling. And because of all this clawing, what will happen? There will be wasting of this hypothenar muscles and there will be hollowing between the metacarpals. Now, this is where both, if there is ulnar and median nerve injury, what will happen? All the four fingers will get involved, because all the four lumbricals will get involved, right? All the four lumbricals, so four fingers also will become like clawed, okay? Now, what is paradoxical clawing? In ulnar nerve injury, if there is a higher ulnar nerve injury, okay, if there's a higher ulnar nerve injury, there is going to be less deformity, less clawing than a low ulnar nerve deformity, because of this FDP muscle and FCU muscle, which are getting involved in the high nerve palsy. That is, look at this. This is the high nerve injury. In high nerve injury, the FDP is involved, so the clawing of the fingers is not much. But in the low nerve injury, that is ulnar nerve is injured at the wrist, there is more clawing of the finger. You can see the fingers are bent more in the low nerve injury because the unopposed action of FDP. So FDP is not affected in low ulnar nerve injury. Okay. Then, even if there is ulnar nerve and median nerve injury, if both the nerves are involved, so the classic too much of clawing won't be there. So these people will have problem in grasping, pinching, etc. So how will you treat it? Zancoli's procedure, tendon transfer. So basically what they are telling is this extensor digitorum, which is hyperextending the metacarpophalangeal joint, take this tendon and transfer it to the interphalangeal joint, so that whatever is extending will get flexed, whatever is getting overflexed will become extended. So you will come back to the normal. So there are a lot of other things that can be transferred, like Paul Brand's procedure is there, where they are talking about the extensor carpi radialis brevis. This is in leprosy also, they are talking about this Paul Brand. Okay. So basically, remember, there are a lot of tendon transfers. You can choose whichever extensor you want to transfer. Zancoli is an important word to know. Okay. So this is how they are showing tendon transfer. Paul Brand, we told you, in leprosy they are talking about. There are a lot of splints also. Knuckle bender, splint, etc. That can you could try. Okay. So that's it, guys, about claw hand in this video. Hope you have understood something. Bye. Guys, see, this is that FDP, FCU that they are talking about, which gets injured in high ulnar nerve injury. These are the two things, okay? FDP and FCU. See, medial epicondyle of the humerus, behind that the ulnar nerve is there. So that's why compression or fracture there will affect the ulnar nerve and cause claw hand, okay?